Give us an early stage of our estimate. Stage 1A, 3 centimeters or less. Yes, need one of these. If our first eye is elevated, the prognosis is really quite good. If one is out of the two is elevated, if they're immediate, both are elevated, then in 5 to 10 year period, 75% of the people are dead. 100% survival, 0% survival, 5 years, 10 years. So even though this is surgical intent up here, there's a population of people who already have micro metastases. Now, past this looking, this is a watercolor that was actually painted by Professor Hariyama, who's an ophthalmologist from Japan. And there was a meeting in 1981 in Greece, at Kim Kukim, in which he presented this data for the very first time that passive smoking increased the risk of lung cancer. At that time, not very many people believed that. But since then, there's been 50 to 80 different papers that have shown in multiple populations, multiple conditions, that passive smoking also is a risk factor. And I sort of like the flowery language of the Pondrides, in which he wrote, some men have constitutions that are like the waterfall, out of the wooded mountain running, with springs, others like those before soil, and little water still, others like land rich, pastures and marshes, and others of the right, earth of the plain. Even at this time, many, many, many centuries ago, physicians recognized that people typically were different from each other, and that they had some conditions that led them to have a poor survival than others. So I was sitting at that meeting, listening to Hariyama, and that was in 81, and I thought, well, I think I know the kind of study I want to do. And it was the following, to look at never smokers who developed lung cancer, and ask the question whether or not to compare smoking. And, but in 1981, it was much too early to do those studies, partly because women didn't start smoking until the Second World War with any frequency. And secondly, the questionnaire was kind of, that was not asked whether or not to compare smoking. So I went back, came back here, and added those kinds of questions and others to our epidemiological case control study. And 20 years later, Susan joined us for a couple of years, and this is 2009, and so we can test that hypothesis. And we found that childhood exposure to secondhand smoke and genetic conditions and innate immunity increased lung cancer risk in never smoking adults. And the smoking of either parent was important in added disease. And even grandparents who took care of the kids they smoked, it contributed to the increased risk. And this was done in two different cohorts. So the conclusion was that, as I promised, the conclusion was that parental secondhand smoking exposure to childhood associated with an increased lung cancer risk of never smokers in their 20 cohorts in 1 year in CI. Especially those who had a nanospiny lectin to amplified then were hyper reactive innate immune system. And one of the surprising results that we found was that these never smokers who had exposure from their mom and their dad at an early age, they developed lung cancer in the 50s instead of the 60s or so. So in many kinds of studies, children are a susceptible population, it's true, in smoking-induced lung cancer. So now we have your genome. So this is your visual view with Jerry and I were initially doing lung cancer research in small cell and then in 87, KRAS was now the oncogene. And then in 2004, there were a number of other mutations found in different EGFR. I want to remind you that the mutation has been known throughout this time. And in 2014, a number of protein kinases were found to be mutated in some cases, listed out fusions, and we were only associated in never smokers. So it's sort of misleading with this increase in these various genes because they rarely occur in smokers who develop lung cancer. Now, what was exciting at the time, and still very interesting, was that these could be targeted. There were a number of different drugs that were developed, and during the third and fourth generation of the NMDA drugs now, the satisfying thing was that there were complete responses to which any tumors just went away. However, within a month or two, they came back. So they were quite temporary, and these drugs cost about $150,000 a year. So it's a key chronic burden on these people. But that's the reality of it.
こちらって様子
に、うん、大
丈夫、あ、すいません、ありがとうございます。
Found that they were found, the microRNAs were found in human cells and tissues. The final trial of Hershey's, which we here. In 2004, found that microRNAs were different from these human cancers, and essentially it's been shown that microRNAs predict risk factors, prognosis, and therapeutic outcome. So as I mentioned, these very small RNAs, usually 24 to 26 base pair, they bind to messages, they get intended translation of that message. But they can also cause instability of the message, especially if there's one or two base changes that are not that lead to the message interacting with the microRNA. MicroRNAs can also bind to proteins, called protein function, and they can even act as ligands. For example, the full receptor ligand that leads to information through IL-6 and TNF. So we're going to start in this area. Joined the lab, and this was some time ago, 10 years ago now. So we found that microRNAs were significantly profiled different between primary blood cancers and coarse metabolic cancer tissues, and among different histological types. So they like microRNAs to determine if they were in the cell or adenoid small cell. And we found that VR21 and 155 and 106 were increased, and there was a decrease in LF7, which is, if you want, a suppressor, a suppressor type of microRNA. That confirmed results from Japan. My colleague was on the machine, that's right, with the TF and that part. And each of these were shown based on your diagnosis of progress, including the earliest stage of lung cancer, stage 1. And then us in collaborating with Carlo Grossi to have a very simple method of running our design for the 6 major types of human cancer, which microRNAs that were known at that time, there were about 290 known at that time, there's well over a couple thousand compounds, were most frequently overexpressed in these cancer types. And VR21 was the one that went great, and that in all these major cancer types, VR21 was most frequently overexpressed. And it was shown by us and others that it was upregulated in 18 major cancer types, and it was the biomarker of the poor survival in at least 14 of those cancer types. So this is some data from our studies of lung cancer that decreased the VR21 equation of lung cancer associated with poor prognosis in 3 different cohorts. This is a very important community type study. It's looking at multiple cohorts, Maryland, in Baltimore, Norway, and these are Kaplan-Meier plots again, 100% survival, 0% survival, 5-year point. So above the median high level for VR21, poor prognosis. As I said, in 18 different cancer types, the high levels of VR21 are associated with poor prognosis. And these are just some examples. These are studies from us, lung and colon, the pancreas, breast, head and neck, tongue, estrogen, cells, leukemia, and so forth. Those are just examples of the high levels of VR21 are associated with poor prognosis. Well, what increases VR21 and what does VR21 do? It's amplified on chromosome 17q. And the latest version from DCGA, which is analyzing the genome of the lung cancer that came out just a few months ago, has shown that one of the common features of lung cancer is amplification at the site, which is associated, of course, with VR21. There could be decreased transcriptional silencing in terms of DNA methylation. This increase can lead to an increase in VR21. We show that EGFR mutations lead to an increase in VR21. So if you have an EGFR mutation, usually, again, it's never spoken. You don't have a KRAS mutation. If you have a KRAS mutation, you usually don't have an EGFR mutation. A number of inflammatory cytokines, such as IL-6, as I talked about a while ago, leads to an increase in STAT3. David Baltimore has always found that. And that STAT3 acts as a promoter, excellent promoter of VR21 transcription effect to increase it. And then some of the people here showed that either free radicals or ionizing radiation has a stress response. Well, what does VR21 do? It does many different things that they do targets. And in each of these cases, it decreases the amount of these various proteins, which are general involved in inhibiting processes related to cancer and cancer progression and metastasis. I mentioned that VR21 can also lead to changes in toll receptors. And this is a hard data from the NSC studies that Carlo Grossi has done, in which VR21 can be the cargo of exosomes, these small 100 nanometer pockets of membrane-bound vesicles that have been infused with immune cells. And when that happens, through the toll receptor, it releases enough gamma-B and the inflammation and increases the metastatic potential. And then they found another interesting finding, which is being explored now in the clinic, the VR21, and also through the exosome, the rapidosis of muscle cells. And this can be associated with congestion. So I don't know how many patients that are caring for congestion, taking care of the hospital. And they just don't want to run their fat, their muscles, and almost universally they die. So antibodies against VR21 might be a study, and that's a hypothesis of being more than in South America, actually. So the transcriptome, that includes the microRNAs, the most important is the messages. And we found that there are four messages that are increased that are associated with survival. So XBO1 that transports microRNAs and other RNAs in the cytoplasm, BRCA1, well, BRCA1, increased BRCA1 from that input then, because low levels of BRCA1 lead to an increased risk of breast cancer. But in fact, high levels of BRCA1 are not considerable. HIF-1 alpha, high levels of that, you might expect that to be found in tumors that are hypoxic, but this is a message level. Hypoxia usually leads to an increase in the protein translation of the message, more than an increase in the message itself. It also decreases in the tumor suppressor gene that's discovered here by Nick Papasio a number of years ago. So these are all stage 1 lung cancers, again, the cancer is less than 3 centimeters in size. In each of these cases, this 4 gene classifier was associated with poor prognosis. And then we looked at 4 new cohorts of stage 1 lung cancer and found that, in fact, the literature that the same observation was observed. So you put all this together and look at odds ratio, and we prefer to use cancer-specific survival. Japanese prefer relapse-free survival, and most people use overall survival, which isn't too bad in lung cancer, but overall survival doesn't take into consideration dying of cardiovascular events or anything else. But anyway, the
I'm Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I I'm going to go to the next one. Thank you.